You heard it. Okay, let's do the good and welfare very quickly then. Tonight's lecture, we're really pleased that we've broken the $5,000 mark with this donation by Mr. Bruno Marques, who is a specialist in Portuguese Jewish history. He's been sending me some really cool stuff that I hope to integrate next year. We also received another $100 donation just today in the mail, so that was really sweet, of something useful for our students and our graduate programs, our undergraduate programs. We also want to give a shout out to our three interns. I think we have two of them here today. They might hear this. Ms. Valerie Braun, Ms. Tahila Feldmaus, and Ms. Tiffany Grossman have done everything to set this place up. Let's see if they can hear. Ms. Grossman, are you there? Ms. Feldmaus? I don't know if they can hear us, but anyway, I'll let them know that we definitely thank them. They took care of all the details with the food and things like that, and they also were really great at developing marketing materials. They were working hard on figuring out how to promote these lectures on the web and design flyers and bookmarks and all kinds of things, so I'm really pleased to have them there doing a great job. Okay, let's go straight to the material then. Tonight's topic, fascinating topic, controversial topic, really someone who embodies a lot of the inner contradictions of the land of Israel in its contemporary attempt to be a modern state in an ancient biblical land. Even though he was born in Israel proper, he is the first ruler of Israel, first prime minister who was actually a Sabra born in Israel. He nevertheless, as according to one of his contemporaries, said he was the most secular Jew he had ever met. Ironically, but this is part of the contradictions that represents the state of Israel. He was born and grew up amidst a series of wars, and in fact, you could tell his life story solely from the perspective of the wars. We will look at several of them in the course of our hour together. But at the end, he was ironically a man of peace, a controversial peace, and we will look at the reasons for the controversy. He died ultimately at an assassin's bullet, ended his life in 1995, and he is honored in Israel as a martyr for the cause of peace, and it is still an elusive peace to this very day. David, could I ask you to shut that door so I'm not distracted by the senator? Thank you very much. Okay, so let's go straight to the story of his life. Here's some photographs to give you a sense of his family background. Both his parents were socialist Zionists. His mother from Belarus was known as Red Rosa Cohen because of her socialist leanings. They were both especially attached to a party called the Poalition. We spoke about them very briefly last week, the Workers of Zion, that tried to create a political philosophy very grounded in actual working of the soil, that was a mixture of secular Zionism with Marxism. Ber Borukhov was the principal ideologue behind this movement that had its greatest impact in the former Russian Empire, but many of the young people who were motivated by Borukhov's ideas came to Israel and founded the kibbutz movement, and ultimately they formed the core of the Labor Party, which dominated Israeli politics up until the late 1970s. So here's a photograph of Red Rosa Cohen and her son Yitzhak on the right and her daughter Rachel on the left over here. Here's another photograph with his father, also of course with his sister Rachel. Father Nechemyo Rubitsov was from Ukraine. He actually emigrated to America, and he spent about a dozen years living in Chicago as a tailor, which is a traditional kind of trade for many Jewish immigrants, the needle trade. My own grandfather, Olive Shalom, and my father, Olive Shalom, were in the needle trade as well. He eventually moved to Israel, also for socialist Zionist reasons, where he met his wife, and they had their first son, Yitzhak, their only son, Yitzhak, in 1922. Later on, of course, Yitzhak went through the ranks, and in the context of World War II, he met his wife, Leah Schlossberg, and he married her. They remained married until his assassination in 1995, and she died 5 years later. She was, of course, very much intertwined with his political career, and we shall see that a small financial peccadillo actually brought him from government as a result of his wife's having a bank account that was illegal at the time. But let's come to that a little later. His life, as I mentioned, really could be traced out through a series of Israel's wars. I've only chosen a few of them because really we could go into tremendous detail on each one of them, but these wars were incredibly important for forming the national identity, and Rabin was personally connected to that identity. In fact, he was a role model for many Jews in understanding what was a sabra. The term, particularly for those on the internet, I'm sure everyone in the room is familiar with the term sabra. It means cactus flower, and it's sort of like a symbol for the Jews who were born in Israel. Do they have a similar kind of thing for people who were born in New York? I don't, Brooklynites, but what does that mean? It's just a place name, right? They have like names for people who are born in certain places. I don't. A sabra, the cactus flower, it's very luscious and moist on the inside, very tasty, but on the outside, of course, it's quite spiny and impossible to eat. And so that's sort of like an emblematic of the Israeli character, hard on the exterior and maybe gruff and rude, but on the inside, very warm and hospitable and so on. When I lived in Israel back when I was 18, living on a kibbutz, there was this Australian guy, and we used to spend a lot of time together, Canadians and Australians, and beer. The three of us were inseparable. And I remember once he found a cactus flower, and he decided just to peel the outer skin very quickly with his knife, and he popped it into his mouth. Little did he realize, of course, that those mature spikes on the outside of the cactus actually come from little tiny immature hair-like spires on the inside of the cactus, and his mouth was full of these things. We had to go to the doctor, and they had to carefully tweezer them out one by one. What a story. Anyways, so he was a sabra who was formed in the crucible of Israel's wars. In particular, he was associated with a pre-state military formation called the Palmach, which later was absorbed into the Haganah, or the Defense Force, which became the Israel IDF, the Israel Defense Force, which is actually, the word Haganah, to defend, is built into the modern term for Tzahal, the forces for the defense of Israel in Hebrew. It was not an easy fit, and in fact, in his memoirs, he wrote quite a bit about the small antagonisms he had with great figures such as Ben-Gurion, the first prime minister of Israel, who wished to break up the Palmach and not allow them to have an individual identity within the IDF, but that's more of detail than we need to go into here. Let's have a look at Israel at the verge of its independence, because this is where he received most of his initial military experience. This is the 1947 UN partition treaty or partition plan of 1947. You'll recall a very quick lightning tour. 1918, the British take over the land of Israel from the Ottoman Empire, and after a brief amount of negotiations, the United Nations, then called the League of Nations, really its predecessor, decided that the British should control all of that region, also Transjordan, the other side of the Jordan River, and so on. This left Israel in an administrative character called the British Mandate. It was controlled by Britain on behalf of the United Nations. The arrangement was not very workable. The Arabs were dissatisfied with the increasing Jewish immigration to Israel. The Jews moving to Israel wanted more power, more self-government, and this only accelerated after the Holocaust when there were so many refugees, something like 20 million displaced people after the war ended, and many of them Jews wishing to go to a new homeland rather than try to recreate their lives in war-destroyed Poland. So ultimately what ended up happening is the British, after trying to negotiate between Jews and Arabs and finding themselves at the expense of violent attacks, they decided to simply give it back to the UN, and the UN thought about it for a while, and it came up with this very unworkable plan, which divided the land of Israel into seven distinct sections. This sort of pinkish area here was supposed to be the Arab states, so there are three Arab state regions with very tiny connections between them. This sort of peachy green, orange color was to be Jewish. And finally, the region of Jerusalem was to be an international zone. It belonged to the international community, would belong to neither Jews and Arabs. So when I teach this to undergraduates who are not necessarily familiar with the history of Israel, they're always amazed when I say to them that at this point, the Arab nations rejected this really bizarre, unworkable map. But the Jews, to my 18-year-old student's surprise, accepted it. Even though it was really an almost impossible amount of territory to defend, it of course did not include Jerusalem, and there was a huge swath of territory between Jewish areas and Jerusalem, which is long regarded by the Jews as their eternal capital. Nevertheless, the Jews accepted it. And war, of course, broke out almost immediately. You can see that even more in how serious it is in the next map that I will show you right over here. This map shows you where Jews actually lived. I mean, the regions that we saw in the previous map were supposed to more or less correspond to the demographics, meaning where they gave territory to where Jews lived. It's actually even thinner. The number of Jews living in a lot of these regions was tiny. And so everyone expected at that time that the Jews, of course, would be thrown into the sea so shortly after the Holocaust, and after a brutal war of just over a year, they ended up being able to actually consolidate territory to the amazement of the world, and the state of Israel survived. Rabin was involved in several important maneuvers. At this point, we should recall that his genius was in logistics, in operations, which was a very important part of war, not so much the, you know, the artillery or the SEALs or the Air Force, but in figuring out what goes where, what has to be placed where and when in order for the troops to succeed, supply lines and munitions and things like that. So he was charged with finding a way to get from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem. You can see the blue areas here are Jewish populations, but the single road that connected them went through a heavily populated Arab area here around the town of Latrun. And it was the site of really serious battles on that single road. There was no way to get around this particular pass where the Arabs could easily ambush Jewish convoys. So Rabin came up with a rather simple but quite ingenious idea to simply bypass Latrun, and he managed to build a very rapidly constructed road, paving it with remarkable speed and enabling essentially the Jewish convoys to make their way from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem without harm. And that was a signal victory without actually engaging in hostilities. And it's characteristic of a lot of things that he was especially good at. After the war, he was invited to participate in the armistice talks. Here's a picture of him. They actually, just to give you a sense of what the Israeli army was like at the time, he had no dress uniforms. They did not issue dress uniforms to their soldiers, a very intentionally casual army, but you couldn't show up to these armistice talks wearing your regular khakis. So they got some World War II uniforms that were hand-me-downs. Remember, this is 1950 already, so it's 5 years after the war, and several people had worn these dress uniforms from a used shop before him. They were ill-fitting, and he put it on. He also he relates in his memoir a funny story that some members of the Arab delegation found out a deeply held secret that he was very embarrassed about. He could never manage to learn, perhaps he learned later in life, but at that point, when he was about late 20s, he didn't know how to tie a tie. And so he actually had a friend tie it for him and leave it on his neck, and he would just loosen the knot every time he needed to take it on and put it off. But he happened to go for a haircut at the same time as one of the members of the Arab delegation, and they saw him loosening his tie, and he was deeply embarrassed. I mean, it's an interesting kind of story because it tells you something about the character of the Israeli army at that time, intentionally casual and very much down to earth and without formalities. The next major war in his life and in the life of Israel was just under 20 years later. We'll skip over. There are smaller skirmishes of nevertheless great importance, the 1956 Sinai campaign in which he was involved. But the Six-Day War is the most momentous, perhaps, of all battles that Israel has ever been involved with. And in fact, we are right now just about at the anniversary of the Six-Day War, the 50th anniversary. The so-called Yom Yerushalayim, the Day of Jerusalem, is on Wednesday, which celebrates the recapture, the reunification of East Jerusalem, which had been cut off from Jews since 1948-49. At any rate, what exactly happened here? We're just going to quickly skim over some of the main facts. I'm sure most of you are very aware of the broad strokes of the war, but we'll focus on Rabin in particular. This man, Gamal Abdel Nasser, the leader of Egypt, was an extremely bellicose individual who managed to engineer a political alignment with Syria that was very significant. Syria, of course, is to Israel's northeast, and Egypt is to its southwest. And Israel was trapped, as it were, between the pincers formed by Egypt and Syria. Their strong political alliance was extremely deleterious to Israel at the time. And tensions with Israel since the War of Independence were really running quite high. Rabin was, to some degree, at this point he was involved as Minister of Defense, I believe. Israel, and Rabin in particular, was to some degree responsible for the escalation of tension in the late 1960s. There were skirmishes in the north, in particular around the Golan Heights, that had to do with various projects to divert water, the national water carrier in Israel that would bring water down from the Lake Kinneret, for example. And there was actually an incident in which there was a dogfight between Soviet MiG fighters and Israeli jets that had launched from northern Syria. So there was a certain amount of tension that Rabin himself was responsible for which he was deeply criticized by many of his rivals in the Israeli government. At any rate, Nasser's response was to mass all of his troops in concert with Syrian troops, Jordanian troops, and Iraqi troops, and to threaten the borders of Israel. Israel was heavily outnumbered by tanks, aircraft, not quite outnumbered in terms of troops, but the only way that Israel would be able to actually amass the same number of troops to fight against these soldiers from the army would be to pull up every single one of their reservists, which would totally paralyze the country economically and otherwise. It means every single person of fighting age brought to the front line. So Israel was clearly outgunned and pretty much outmanned by all of the other armies at the same time. And Egypt, in a very bellicose way, threatened the United Nations and challenged them to remove their observers from the border that was separating Israel and Egypt. Perhaps to Nasser's surprise, the Secretary General of the UN actually did so. He actually abandoned the front line. There are some theorists that say that Nasser was expecting that, you know, this is part of the rhetoric, and, you know, you make these noises and the UN might retreat to a part of the border, but he simply removed the border, and this, to a certain degree, that meant that the region was going to spiral into war. There's also some interesting questions about how much Nasser knew and what exactly he thought about what Israel was doing, because he got some misinformation from the Soviets. Oh, definitely. The Soviets are heavily involved in this. Let's just remember, this is before Vietnam, but after Korea. So we're talking about the Arabs and the Israelis are fighting a proxy war on behalf of the Soviets and the Americans, respectively. So the signals confusion between these four parties and their overlapping but not at all identical political and foreign policy objectives often meant there's a lot of confusion on the ground. For example, one of the most bizarre incidents in the war that brought us much closer to, you know, that DEFCON 3 moment was when the Israelis fired on an American vessel in the Mediterranean. The Israelis had thought originally that it was an Arab vessel that had entered its waters, And then later, for a moment, they had a bone-curdling thought that perhaps it was the Soviets that they had actually fired upon, and that would draw the Soviets into the war. And then they found out actually it was the Americans. They had just sunk an American ship. And they immediately sent apologies straight back to Washington and so on. And don't forget, when I say immediately, this is 1967 we're talking about. So immediately is kind of like a few pigeons flying very fast, you know, by comparison to internet speeds. I know no one's laughing here. I thought it was funny. But, you know, they use cables. That's the best they would have. It's even before fax machines. So it turned out that America, there was a signals confusion, and they had told all of their boats, as they were, you know, told in advance that Israel was going to attack. They had removed all their boats in these waters, but they had neglected to inform this one particular boat. And so this one particular boat was in harm's way. And when it was fired on, the Americans actually thought it was the Soviets who had sank them. And if the Americans thought it was the Soviets, then they would go to war with the Soviet Union, and we would risk, you know, Armageddon. Okay. Back to where we are. They launch around all this area, and then at this point, Rabin, who you will recall is Minister of Defense, deeply involved in this, and may be to some degree responsible for the escalation of tensions. It's rapidly getting out of control. The leadership of the military and political elite of Israel are really not certain what to do, because if they enter into war, it's quite likely that Israel would be destroyed. Rabin has a nervous breakdown of some kind. His rival Moshe Dayan would step in. What exactly was this nervous breakdown? It's kind of a bizarre story. Rabin, in his memoirs, he attributed it to literally nicotine poisoning. He had been going without sleep for several days on end, smoking one cigarette after another. This is Israel in the 1960s, after all. And the combination of the stress, the exhaustion, the tension, and all this nicotine just laid him out for 30 hours straight. And this is a really bad time for the Minister of Defense to be offline. To think of him as not being involved in it, just disappearing, it was terrible. And the many of his rivals, including Moshe Dayan, Ezer Weitzman, and others, felt that, you know, that's it. He's out. We can't rely on him. He is emotionally too weak for this position. He managed, after he slept for nearly 2 days, he came back to himself, and he managed to reassert himself, but there was a lot of questions about his reliability after that one night. He's not even sure how to respond to it. But at any rate, the decision was made that Israel would launch a preemptive strike. And this has been a controversial decision, but ultimately it was of huge consequence for Israel as a nation. They took advantage of several factors related to their air superiority. Israel was outnumbered in terms of fighter planes, but they were much better trained. And again, you can see Rabin's influence here. They had much better logistics. They were able to fly 4 sorties a day, whereas the Egyptians were used to flying 1 or at most 2. And so they planned for a dawn raid. They also did some really good intelligence analysis of when the Egyptian pilots had breakfast. And they tended to fly all of their planes out at the same time in the pre-dawn hours. They would come back for breakfast at exactly 7 a.m. And at that point, all their planes would be on the ground while they were inside having couscous and hard-boiled eggs. So the Israelis planned that attack for the very first wave to go over the Suez Canal, and amazingly, they planned 3 waves of attacks, but the first wave completely decimated the Egyptian Air Force on the ground. They were completely destroyed. Photographs like this of planes and runways completely destroyed. This one actually has been a bit cleared. Actually, I'm not even sure this is a runway, but once they demonstrated air superiority over Egypt, they had the run of the skies, and the rest of the war basically fell into place with remarkable precision. So it was a tremendous execution. The planning that went into it was executed flawlessly, and the war was an amazing success. What ended up happening was, and really you have to imagine that prior to the outbreak of the war, Everyone was thinking this is going to be it. This is disaster. Israel is all over. It's going to be another Holocaust. Jews from all around the world. You know, my uncle, for example, talks about how he rushed around to get an airline ticket to get to Israel. But by the time his flight was about to leave, the war was already over. It was like a phenomenal turnaround of global proportions. This yellow here shows you the armistice line of 1949, that is after the War of Independence that gave Israel its statehood. Israel conquered the entire Sinai Peninsula, the Gaza Strip here, the region which goes by its biblical names, Shomron and Yehuda, or by its contemporary term, the West Bank, because the West Bank of Jordan, and peachy color in the top is the Golan Heights, a region in the north that separates Israel and Syria. It was a victory beyond all proportions. They had no idea that they were actually going to conquer this much territory. And in fact, it would prove to be quite an albatross that Israel would have to deal with, because immediately afterwards, the Israeli elite was thinking, okay, great, we conquered all this territory. Now all we have to do is wait for the Arab nations to call us up, and we'll make a deal, we'll trade land for peace, and we'll finally have peace. The problem is that the phone call did not come for another 10 years, and they had a couple of wars in the meantime, so things did not work out as planned. But in 1967, it was an overwhelming Israeli victory that the rest of the world really could not comprehend. Perhaps the most significant element of that war, on an emotional level, of course, is the reunification of Jerusalem, which was captured in this iconic photograph. The old city, in particular, the Kotel, the western wall of the old temple that was the center of Jewish worship for thousands of years, was cut off to Jews after 1949. And with the recapture of Jerusalem in this war, with very heavy, you know, door-to-door fighting in the old city, when it once again came under Israeli control, it was more than just a certain amount of territory. This was like capturing the capital city. It was the golden prize, and it brought tears to the eyes of Jews all around the world that the Kotel was once again under Israeli control. So Rabin goes on from here to eventually become the Prime Minister of Israel. Most significant thing that happens in the meantime, of course, is the Yom Kippur War, which immediately preceded his rise to becoming Prime Minister. The Yom Kippur War, which we won't go into in great detail, but was engineered by this man, Anwar Sadat, also the Prime Minister of Egypt, and he was able to launch a surprise attack on the holiest day of the Jewish year, when Jews were all fasting and so on. It was a huge soul-searching moment for the state of Israel. They were able, of course, to eventually push back the attackers, but only after a great number of casualties. And it proved that the sense of Davidic-like superiority that had overwhelmed the Israelis in 1967 could not be guaranteed. And that was true for the Israeli mentality and also true for the Arab mentality, because it showed that the Jews could get a bloody nose in the sense of the horrible devastation of the Yom Kippur War. And it also meant that Anwar Sadat, once he had, even though he didn't really win that war, the borders were pushed right back to where they were prior to the war, nevertheless, he showed that he could inflict damage on the Israelis, which gave him a sense of pride once again, gave the nation of Egypt a sense of pride, and then the tables were more level, as it were, and he was able to reach out to the Israelis amazingly and sue for peace. And so, in fact, over the course of the next few years, Egypt and Israel would eventually dictate a peace treaty. This would be a traditional land for peace deal in which the Sinai Peninsula was given back to the Egyptians, and the Egyptians then respected the border with Israel. Gaza, however, was very problematic. Egypt did not want to take Gaza back. It was heavily populated, a lot of unhappy people living there, and they left it in Israel's backyard. But During this time, Shimon Peres emerged as Rabin's greatest rival. The two of them worked together on so many things. They were both labor Zionists. They were both in the same political party. But Rabin was more hawkish and Peres was more dovish. Peres really wanted to make more efforts to make peace with the surrounding Arab peoples, and later, of course, with the Palestinians living within Israel proper. And Rabin, through most of his life, until really the very end, he was much more in favor of the iron fist. He was much more in favor of using force to be able to achieve political aims. He was a child of the 1967 war, the War of Independence, like Peres, but definitely not similarly minded. At this point, he became prime minister after the 1973 Yom Kippur War, and he came into conflict with the religious parties. And I'd like to mention this particular incident primarily because it sort of demonstrates the fissures within Israeli society per se. The Israeli governments are not formed the same way the American government is. Here in America, we basically have a binary political system where the ruling party, with very few exceptions in American history and only weird kind of things back like who knows when in the 1800s, it's either Democrat or Republican. You can only have either or. You can't really, you know, independents really don't have a stake or a chance to win the election. That's the way Americans think, I believe. But in Israel, you can't have that. In Israel, there are so many gradations of political opinion, and the spectrum is so much broader that they have literally tens of political parties, none of which has ever been able to achieve majority status. You have 120 seats in Knesset. Never has a political party been able to get 61 of those. So every single government has to be a coalition. Let's say one of the big parties gets 40 seats. Let's say Rabin's party of labor gets 40 seats. So they have to make deals with 21 other parties or 21 other seats, which are in smaller blocks. The vegetarians have 3 seats. Maybe we can make a deal with them, lower prices on carrots, you know, and the communists, they want, you know, a particular type of school system. Fine, we'll deal with them. And then a government, once they get 21 seats, they get 61 altogether, then they have a block and they can rule the government. That's a coalition style government. So it really depends on a lot of internal negotiation between these various political movements. And one of the most common marriages of convenience up until the 1970s in particular, was of these socialist anti-religious Zionists like Rabin and the religious parties. You know, the Agudat Yisrael, the Degel HaTorah, different parties like this. So one of the specific incidents that came up was over a gift to or a sale to Israel of several F-15 fighters from the United States. And the Israeli government scheduled the arrival of those planes on Israeli territory on a Friday afternoon, which is not wise because, you know, you have to schlep around and you have to get things ready for Shabbos and you have to light candles and things like that. Having all these expensive planes fly in on a Friday afternoon means that someone is going to desecrate the Sabbath. And so the Haredi, the ultra-Orthodox Agudat Yisrael party, voted on a motion of no confidence, meaning they were so upset with this government for breaking what was the religious standard, as they felt. So they wanted to get 60 other seats to agree that we should drop out of this government. That's another thing that doesn't happen so much in America. In this country, if you want to change the government outside of the regular election cycles, you have to impeach somebody or shoot somebody, God forbid. That happens too. But, you know, basically, you know, you have to have a real trauma to get off that cycle. In Israel, all you have to do is have one vote of no confidence. And if 61 seats vote, they have no confidence in leadership, new elections. And it could be 3 weeks after the last elections. You never really know. So the Agudat Yisrael said, what a shanda, what a chilul Hashem, what a desecration of God's name that we should have these F-15 fighters land on Erev Shabbat. We vote no confidence. So Agudat Yisrael was not part of the coalition, but the National Religious Party, who were more moderate Zionists, they were as they, in what one of my friends calls Yarmul culture. They tended to wear the white knitted kippot with the blue emblems on it. So they're more Zionistic, but also observant the Shabbat. They didn't want to bring the government down, but they didn't want to acquiesce to the Agudat Yisrael either. So what they did was they abstained from voting. And Rabin was just incensed with them. He had a huge fight, kicked them out of the government. It was a big mess. And I put this today's article from the Jewish Telegraphic Agency to show you that, like my father, Allah Shalom, used to say, plus ça change, plus c'est la même chose. These kinds of fights over flying on Shabbat exist even today. Okay. But what really brought Rabin down, and this is one of these great ironies of Israeli politics, you know, I skipped over very quickly that he spent many years as an ambassador here in Washington. And his wife and he had an American bank account with about 10,000 American dollars in it. In the late 70s and early 80s, Israel was going through a tremendous period of hyperinflation where, I mean, I was living there at that time and I used to work in a pizza shop called Richie's Cardo Cafe. And every Friday or whatever day it was that we used to get paid, they would calculate how much we would get paid against the American dollar. Because we didn't know what the exchange rate was going to be any given week. Nobody got paid in dollars because they didn't have them. You always got paid in shekels, but the shekels were calculated against the value of the dollar because it could vary from week to week. So in an attempt to try and control the currency, they put in place a regulation. Nobody, no Israeli is allowed to have a foreign bank account. That was considered unpatriotic because you're protecting your money outside of the country. We need your money right here inside Bank Leumi and Bank Hapoalim. And we don't want you to put your money into, I don't know, the Chase or whatever it was. So when a journalist discovered that Leah Rabin had a bank account from when she was the ambassador's wife here in Washington, it was a huge scandal, and it actually forced Rabin to resign from the government, and new elections were held as a result. Gives you a sense of the kind of the tenor of the age. That law no longer applies. You can have as many bank accounts as you want. Thank God the economy there is much better. But the real devastation to Rabin's party occurred later on in the 1970s when you had a major revolution in Israeli political culture. Up until this point, from the first election in the late 1940s to the late 1970s, Israel's political establishment was dominated by the Ashkenazi Eastern European elite. Rabin was a bit of an exception because he was a Sabra, born in Israel, but he was, of course, of Ashkenazi extraction, and there was this, you know, kind of sense of entitlement that the Ashkenazim were much more civilized, much more cultured, much more educated. These Sephardim, coming from Arab lands in particular, the Edut HaMizrach, the Yemenites, and things like that, there was a feeling like, they, you know, we have the white man's burden with regards to these other Jews. And there was really an apartheid-like society in many ways between the Ashkenazim and the Sephardim. So in the late 1970s, there was like this internal revolution where the Sephardim rose up and they said, we are just not going to support this socialist Zionist model that is hostile to our religious values. And we don't like all this dovish stuff, especially that we hear from Shimon Peres. And they voted for a new party, Likud, under the leadership of this man, Menachem Begin, who was a follower of Vladimir Jabotinsky. You recall we spoke about him many, many months ago. Menachem Begin, much more hawkish than anyone out there, much more religious, much more nationalistic. And in 1977, there was a huge revolution within the mindset of Israelis. It was the renaissance of the Sephardic bloc of voters that has had a continuing influence to the present day. Okay, now to the last period of Rabin's life, and very significant in many ways. Rabin was still at the very top of power. Don't forget, even when Begin came to power in 1977, he did not have a majority government. He still had a minority government, which had to have the participation of various other parties. And we should recall that the way they choose members to occupy certain seats in the government, the ministry, is that each party populates a ticket with a number one member of the party, number two member of the party, number three member of the party. And when they negotiate seats in the Knesset and ministries, they give those ministries to the top members of each of those lists. So even though Rabin's party was not in power, he was very close to the top of the list, if not at the top. And so quite often he was occupying a ministerial post. It was in this context that he was called upon to deal with the first Intifada. The Intifada is something which has grown in Israel, unfortunately, and has become a persistent problem for the state. It refers, and I wish we had a lot more time to talk about this, but it refers to a very important change in tactics on the part of the Palestinians in particular. I will use that term specifically now rather than Arabs, because in the 1960s, that's when the concept of Palestinian, as distinct from, you know, Arabs who live in Israel, became very prominent. The Palestinians at this point had organized themselves, and in many ways the Palestinians had expressed their lack of confidence in their Arab leaders of other lands, and the leaders of Egypt, leaders of Syria. They said, like, what have you done for us lately? You keep on having these big wars, but, you know, what do we get out of it? In the end, you'll make a peace deal like Egypt, and we get nothing out of it. So the Palestinians, beginning in the late 1980s, began to mobilize themselves for a grassroots uprising against Israel. I remember distinctly, because I lived in Israel in the early 80s, how, I'm sure many of you were there at that time, how amazingly safe it was. Like, even though you did have the occasional horrible terrorist attack, you could walk with ease through Arab neighborhoods, identifying as a Jew, and no one would bother you. I was studying at Hebrew University at the time. I used to live on Har HaTzofim, the Mount Scopus campus, which is kind of separate from Jerusalem. And I used to, you know, every day walk down the hill, walk through the Arab neighborhood, through the Arab quarter of the old city to my job in the Jewish quarter of the old city. And then I would walk back at night, and it was no problem whatsoever. It was just, you know, some guy walking in the street. But that you couldn't say that 5 years later after the Intifada began. The tactics of the Intifada involved low-level resistance, acts of smaller violence, acts of disobedience that the big guns of the Israeli defense establishment were not capable of handling. Rock throwing became the emblematic form of resistance, especially by children and youths, because, you know, Israel might have had all of these fantastic tanks and these bazookas and fighter planes, but how do you use those things effectively against children throwing stones? The stones are dangerous, so you have to do something about it, but how do you possibly control it with a modern military? And also add to the fact that Israel is a democracy with a free press, an incredibly free press, and there are always photographers around. Sometimes these events are even staged. Israel was terribly losing the propaganda war over the impression of how they were handling their Arab populations. So the Intifada, although it did not achieve any great military aims, it nevertheless changed the paradigm of the image of who was Israel and who were the Palestinians in this context. And we still live with that major paradigm shift where suddenly Israel is the aggressor, Israel is the Goliath, no longer the David, and Israel has attempted, with only limited success, to try and change that narrative, which is very widely endorsed in much of contemporary society, particularly in the universities that are our competitors. That's why all of you Jewish students out there who want to get an undergraduate education should come here because we don't have to deal with that. At any rate, Rabin tried the hard fist. He imported methods used in South Africa to try and quell disturbances against apartheid with rubber bullets and water cannons and various types of armed personnel carriers, and it just dug a deeper and deeper hole every time there was a small incident of rock throwing on the news. And he was simply not succeeding against this. The intifada, the word apparently, I don't know Arabic, but it apparently is the term used for like a violent shaking, like when a dog is wet and wants to shake off the water. Like instead of having the PLO's troops in Egypt or the Syrians, the Lebanese, and so on come in and invade, it was going to be like a shaking off the Israelis kind of mentality. And it was very heavily practiced in the West Bank and in the Gaza Strip. And Israel had to cope by trying to limit the civil rights of non-Israeli citizens, where movement was restricted, checkpoints were put in place, bags were checked for bombs everywhere you went, and ultimately, under Sharon, much later, an actual physical wall was built to try and separate the Arab citizens living, or the Arab population in Israel, the Palestinians, from the Jewish population. It should also be noted, of course, that there are 750,000 Arab citizens of Israel who have freedom of movement throughout the country and on occasion would collude with non-citizens from the West Bank and Gaza, which only made the Intifada all the worse. And there was no easy solution in sight, certainly not then. Even today, it still remains a deep problem. So what he did was very counterintuitive for his life history. And this is probably why he is so controversial among many circles today. He decided that if he could not win this war with arms, he would win it with peace. Very dramatic gesture, a 180-degree turnaround for much of his way of thinking. Part of the reason for this was because now we're getting to the first Intifada started in 1986. By 1991, the Soviet Union was collapsing. And you'll recall that most of the traditional Arab-Israeli conflict was predicated on the support of the Americans for the Israelis and the Soviet Union for the Palestinians. When the Soviet Union itself was disappearing, there was a real fear what would happen to the Palestinian movement. Many people who might have been more short-sighted politically would say, well, this is great. The Palestinians will have less funds flowing to their central organizations, and therefore they will be weaker. Rabin's thinking was, wait a second, right now I deal primarily with one enemy. His name is Yasser Arafat. He's the leader of the Palestine Liberation Organization. Israel had did a great job of making sure he was unwelcome in any of the countries that bordered Israel. They actually waged wars against Egypt, Jordan, Lebanon, Syria, and Arafat at this point was forced to live in Tunis because he was not welcomed in any of those Arab nations. He was still the figurehead, though, of the Palestinian movement. And Rabin's thinking was, if I don't make peace with Yasser Arafat now, then I will have to fight against 1,000 Yasser Arafats who command much smaller but very dangerous groups of terrorists. So Rabin, in many ways like Anwar Sadat, took the first step and he picked up the phone to speak to Yasser Arafat and propose discussions for peace. Ironically, like Anwar Sadat, he was assassinated by a compatriot for this very bold decision. But what ended up happening is Arafat chose to take him up on this offer. And in this iconic photograph, brokered by the Americans under Bill Clinton, they actually struck a deal called the Oslo Accords, because much of the negotiation took place in Oslo, Norway. This is essentially the foundation of America, actually up until today, because we don't know what happened in Israel. We'll have to read Trump's speech later, President Trump's speech. But up until today, the so-called roadmap that has been followed by all of the European nations, led by America, has argued towards implementing some version of the Oslo Accords of 1993. Basically, what do they ask for? Accepting Gaza, which no longer was relevant because in 2003, under a different administration, Israel simply abandoned Gaza to the Arabs living there. In the West Bank in particular, the idea was to slowly establish confidence-building measures that would allow Israel a sense of security living next to a demilitarized Palestinian state. And so they looked at the demographics in the region. They set aside Jerusalem because they knew it was too thorny an issue. The Palestinians regard Jerusalem as their capital, as the Jews also regarded as theirs. And so they said, okay, those areas where there's lots of Palestinians, Area A, we will give the Palestinians local control of things like sanitation, local policing, education, whatever it is that they want to do for self-government, the Israelis will allow that to happen. In other areas, there will be Palestinian administration, but the Israelis will maintain security in these kind of greenish, yellow areas here. And in the white areas in between, the area C, it's areas that still have to be negotiated. That's the core of the Oslo Accords. The goal was the Palestinians would slowly demonstrate that they are capable of preventing acts of terror against the Israelis. The Israelis would slowly retreat from political and even territorial control over these regions, and gradually, the theory went, they would move towards a two-state solution. Obviously, here we are 20 years later, 93, yeah, 20 years later, 20 and some, 25 odd years later, and we still don't have it for a variety of reasons, but the Palestinians were incapable of taking those measures. There continued to be a wave of horrific suicide attacks, especially in the early 2000s. And Palestinians will say that Israel reneges on its part of the deal by continuing to build settlements. Settlements are facts on the ground, meaning once you've got a group of people living in a place, it is incredibly difficult to uproot them and move them away. And so there's this ongoing back and forth between both groups. I'm not here to give a political equivalency between those the arguments, but nevertheless, that is where we are deadlocked to this day. For his part, Rabin was praised by the global community and by Israelis to left of center in particular for taking this bold move and actually, they felt, kind of guaranteeing some safety for the Israelis. I see your question just a second. But on the other hand, many Israelis felt that this was a betrayal of Israeli values because he was giving away some of the cherished land of Israel itself. This has both political consequences, security consequences, and perhaps most significantly, religious consequences, because many in Israeli society felt that the land of Israel would expand in order to absorb the immigrants that would return to Israel along with the coming of the Messiah. And so by ceding land, you're actually stepping backwards from the unfolding of the Messianic era. And Rabin came under incredible criticism as a result. So much so that even though, as you can see in this picture here, he won the Nobel Prize for Peace, he shares it here with Yasser Arafat and Shimon Peres, he does not look terribly thrilled to be receiving it. Maybe he's not terribly thrilled to be standing on the same stage with Arafat, because he's now the former hawk who is now receiving the Peace Prize. But this man, Yigal Amir, in 1995, approached Rabin in a public square and shot him in the back several times in revenge for enacting the Oslo Peace Accords. The spot where he is buried is now a national monument and a shrine, and he was eulogized by world figures all over, not the least of which is Bill Clinton, who famously said of him, in Hebrew, Shalom Chaver, goodbye, my friend. So with that, we'll conclude the remarks on a complex figure, played a great role in the shaping of Israel's polity, a war hero who became a dove, someone who left a lasting mark on the land of Israel. Thank you very much for your attention, and I look forward to speaking with you next semester. Yes.